And we're live. Thank you, Lynn. Thank you, Lenny. So, man, I feel like we're on a game show tonight. It's Lynn and Lenny. So, you know. Good evening, everyone. Glad you are here tonight. And if you're watching online, welcome. Yes, I am not Brother Tommy. My name is Mark. I'm the associate pastor here. Brother Tommy is off, headed down to Louisiana for a little bit with him and Shelley. And so for tonight and next week, I will be teaching for him. And I'm go ahead and tell you, we're in the book of Colossians. If you've been here when I've taught, this probably comes as no surprise to you, because except for December of last year, every time I've covered for Brother Tommy, I've been in Colossians. I just love this book. And we're going to be in chapter 2 tonight, only looking at the first three verses. I wanted to look at verses 1 through 6, but God did not have that in store. So we're just going to look at the first three verses tonight. We're going to dig in a little bit, and then we'll kind of pull everything, tie everything together next week. So as we get started, let's pause for prayer, and then we'll jump in. Father, we thank you for tonight. Father, I know there are many people hurting. Father, there are some people I know dear to me that are going through a very tough time. You know their needs. You know what the situation is. Father, I lift them up to you. Father, I know everybody else in here, those watching online, God, that if they're not going through something, I know that they know that somebody, they know somebody else that is. So, Father, we pray for your wisdom, pray for your guidance. Father, for your glory to be seen. Father, for your truth to be made known. Guide us tonight as we jump into this wonderful letter that Paul wrote to the church at Colossae. And Father, I pray that we pull things out of it today. Father, you've already challenged me, and I pray that that others will be drawn to you through your word. We love you. It's in Christ's name. Amen. So I got, as I was studying, I got hung up. You will find out where I got hung up and just decided to just go digging in. And God was kind of working on me in a few ways. And so out of that, I just kind of snipped everything at 1 to 3. God said, okay. And so we're going to go with it. So as a quick review about Colossians, if I can get this to the tech guy, here we go. Colossians was led by Epaphras, the church at Colossae. We see in chapter 4, Paul writes that Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, sends you greetings. He's always wrestling for you in his prayers so that you can stand mature and fully assured in everything God wills. For I testify about him that he works hard for you, for those in Laodicea and for those in Aeropolis. Colossae, Laodicea, Aeropolis was kind of a triangle, kind of like the Tri-Cities. It was kind of a triangle of cities that are very close to each other in this time. And Epaphras came to know Christ in Exodus, and we read about that in Acts. And Paul trained him and equipped him and sent him into this area. Laodicea is about 9 miles away from Colossae. And so he was a very influential pastor at that time in those churches. Colossians is one of Paul's prison letters. He was writing to them because the church at Colossae was facing some very strong heretical teachings. Most scholars, the majority of them, aren't really sure exactly by name what the group was, but it was more of a Gnostic mystic. There's a secret knowledge you can attain. Jesus is kind of a way to wisdom, but we have the secret way to wisdom. And so a lot of it was just kind of theory, just kind of postulated, and it was beginning to sway some of the people out of the church. And so Paul was writing out of these issues that he was being told about. Paul had not met any member of the Colossian church. He had not physically walked in the church. He didn't know who they were, what they looked like. The only thing he knew about them is what was being reported back to him by Epaphras. And so that's kind of a quick synopsis, a quick review of what's going on. And Colossians really centers around who Christ is, because chapter 1 is a heavy dose of Christology, a theology of Christ. Who is Jesus? What is his role in creation? Who is he in relation to the Godhead? Very heavy in that. And then Paul begins to transition in the first three verses of chapter 2, and you really see his heart open up. You see the goal that he has for this letter, and I believe it's a goal that we need to really dig into and pay attention to in the time that we live. Because we're going to see that there has to be a balance in not just what we know intellectually about Scripture and about God and what we know about Christ, but the love that we experience through Him, we have to experience it and love others. Because knowing God is more than just knowing, okay, the middle verse of the Bible, the third word is this, more than kind of trivia stuff. And so we're going to be digging into that as we go. So let's look at what the first three verses say. For I want you to know how greatly I am struggling for you, for those in Laodicea, and for all who have not seen me in prison, or in person, sorry. I want their hearts to be encouraged, joined together in love, so that they may have all the riches of complete understanding and have the knowledge of God's mystery, Christ. In Him are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And right here in those last few the last little bit where he's like, all knowledge is found in God's mystery, Christ, all treasures. He's taking a swing at these heretical teachings. He's going ahead and saying, I'm calling you out because there's not some hidden knowledge to attain. There's not some secret knowledge that you can strive for. Know Christ and you have everything. All the treasure of wisdom, all the treasure of a relationship, all the treasure of knowledge is found in Christ. And so we're going to focus just one verse at a time. Verse 1, the word struggling, it comes out of the Greek. I'm not a Greek scholar, so I spent a lot of time utilizing resources that I have. So I hope I've got all this right and how this is applied and what this means. But the word struggling is the word agona, the root word for what we get with agony. Now, it has a couple of applications to give you the idea of what struggling means. Agona has a reference to Greek athletic competitions. Wrestling, the races, the Colosseum where all these activities, the Olympics would take place, they would struggle for the prize. It was an agona. They were struggling to win, and it was their report and records that the competition was so fierce, it would just kind of tear everybody down. And so you have this great struggling, but you also have it being used in a way that is encouraging. We see it in 1 Timothy 6. Fight the good fight of faith. Struggle in a positive manner. Struggle for the faith. Struggle for the cross. This particular word, agona, now there are other variations of it, like different endings and such, but this particular word only appears 6 times in the New Testament. 5 of them are used by Paul. In Philippians 1:30, Colossians 2:1, which we just read, 1 Thessalonians 2:2, 1 Timothy 6:12, I'm sorry about that, not 1 Timothy 12, but 6:12, and then 2 Timothy 4:7, we see this aspect of struggling, of pressing, of doing everything it takes to fight the good fight of faith. The sixth use is used by the writer of Hebrews in chapter 12, verse 1, about the great many witnesses that are cheering, that are struggling on for you. And there are similar words concerning Epaphras in verse 4, in chapter 4, verse 12, which we read just a minute ago, that he is always wrestling for you in his prayers, agona. He's always struggling. He's losing sleep. He's going to bed crying. He's going to bed with this anxiety that, have I taught everything I can teach? Have I shared with who I can share? Who are the ones that have rejected Christ that I need to go back and share with? But that is what the struggling, the agonizing is about. And we see, especially in Ephesians 6:18, pray at all times in the Spirit with every prayer and request. Stay alert with all perseverance and intercession. Paul agonized over the church universal. He took personal interest in every church that was planted by him or by somebody he equipped and trained. He was concerned about the church universal when it came to how he related to Peter and James and John when they went to Jerusalem. He agonized. He struggled. He wrestled. so that everybody would know who Jesus Christ is. He struggled so that everybody would have the right view of Scripture, the right view of God. He was in agony over people coming to know Christ. Moving on to verse 2. This is where I really started digging in. He breaks things down into three goals. This is really the crux. This is why he wrote Colossians. He wants people to be encouraged. Paraklethosin. I'm not going to try that again. To exhort, to comfort, be encouraged, a way to be a Barnabas, to be an encourager, to uplift, to be there when somebody is hurting, to rejoice when somebody rejoices. Be encouraged. He wants people to be encouraged. I want their hearts to be encouraged, to be comforted, to be exhorted, and joined together in love. And he uses the word agape here. And this is where I went on my rabbit trail. Because we're called to love with an agape love. We're called to love as God loves. And I know that sounds like a high task. I know that sounds like a big task. But when I started digging in other passages, not just Paul's writings, but others' writings, the same word or a form that comes off of agape is used consistently with the love we are to show one another. Matthew 22, 37, that's supposed to be through 39. Man, my typing skills are off. He said to him, talking about Jesus, love, agapesis, the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the greatest and most important command. The second is like it. Love, agapesis, your neighbor as yourself. So everything we have, with everything we got, with all that who we are to love God, and then we are to love others with that same love and intensity. John 15, 13, no one has greater love. Our theme verse from this past Easter, no greater love, no greater love, agapen, than this, to lay down his life for his friends. To love so much you're willing to lay down your life. John 13, 34 through 35, I give you a new command. Love one another, agapate, just as I have loved agapesa, which is the past, kind of the past participle, past tense form of agape. You are also to love, agapate again. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you agapen one another. And I tell you, God really started hitting at my heart going, Mark, are you really loving people with everything that you've got? Are you loving them the way that you want to love me? And he was like, do you even love me the way that you want to? And I kept digging. I didn't type out, put in all of 1 Corinthians 13. But there are three uses of agapen. There are six uses of agape. Nine times the word love is used in 1 Corinthians 13, and they're all a form of agape, of that perfect love. Colossians 3:14, just one chapter over of where we're at tonight. Above all, put on love, agapen, which is the perfect bond of unity. When we are loving others the same way we are loving God, there is going to be unity in the body of Christ. There is going to be unity in mind and in heart and in action. There's going to be unity in effort. I didn't say uniformity, but I said unity. Why do I not say uniformity? Because all of our gifts are different. God has given us each individual unique gifts that overlap and weave together to form this fabric of the church that God wants to use to cover his love and to share the gospel and to stand up for his word and to be held together. I don't mind getting in front of people and talking. I know that is a shock to everybody. I have family members and I know people, you ask them to stand up here and especially put those three lights up, you won't get them in this room. You may not even get them on the property. Do what? Oh, I thought I heard some. But they prefer to be behind the scenes. They don't want the spotlight. They want to make sure everything's put together. They want to make sure that what they're doing is what they need to do. You've got people that are great at encouraging. You've got those that are great at listening. Those, and everybody has their unique gifts. We all have the same calling, which is to serve God with everything that we have and love others as we love God. We're called to share the gospel. We see that in the Great Commission. We're called to grow. We're called to be rooted in the faith. But God has gifted us differently so that we weave together. And we're bound in unity by love. Now, Peter also uses this. 1 Peter 1, 22 and 23. Since you have purified yourselves by your obedience to the truth, so that you show sincere brotherly love, agapesate, I pray that's how you pronounce it. I may try to quit pronouncing these, I don't know, for each other, from a pure heart, love one another constantly, that's another form. Because you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. And then three chapters later, above all, maintain constant love, agapen, for one another, since love covers a multitude of sins, being hospitable to one another without complaining. So if we are called to, that our hearts want to be encourage, our hearts to be encouraged and to be joined together in love, there's got to be time that we are spending with God, growing in our relationship with Him to love others the way that we're supposed to. Because I find personally, if I'm not spending my time with God that I need to, I may not relate as well to my family as I need to. And I'm just going to end it right there. But when I am in God's presence, experiencing His love, man, my day is different. I have a different outlook. My mind is in a different place, in a better place. One of my favorite passages comes out of 1 John 4, and it's just, as you can tell, all over the place, reaffirming that we have to love as God loves. Dear friends, let us love one another, because love, agape, is from God, and everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Ooh, that's a tough one. The one who does not love does not know God, because God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent His one and only Son into the world so that we might live through Him, love through Him, serve through Him. Love consists in this, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, if God loved us in this way, we also must love one another. And every one of them is a form of agape. It's not phileo. It's not any of the other words that they use. This is pure love that we are giving preference to God. We are giving preeminence to God in our lives. And we are going to love others with the same intensity that we love God. And so taking this, just these first 2 points in verse 2, and we look at the fact that there's this heretical teaching, and Paul has already taken a swing saying, look, all wisdom is found in Christ. That is God's mystery, is Christ. We see his 2 big points. God's mystery is Jesus. The gospel of Christ is the way to eternity. But we also see that just knowing the intellectual aspect of Scripture is not enough. Understanding also comes through the love Christians share for one another. Because in that, then we understand what living out the gospel means. We understand what equipping the saints and being rooted means. We understand what rejoice with those who rejoice, mourn with those who mourn. We understand what those mean, and God shows up and shows us more about who He is as we are experiencing Him together. Matthew 18:20, for where two or three are gathered together in my name, I'm there among them. So if we're going to be loving one another, if we're going to be loving Him, going back to Matthew 22, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your mind. That's the greatest commandment. The second is love your neighbor as yourself. If we're going to love God and love others, when we're gathered together, Jesus is there. And we're not just understanding him intellectually through the scripture, we're understanding him relationally as we journey through life together, as we're encouraging one another, as we're listening and sharing with one another and supporting one another. When we know we have that friend, family member, or coworker that needs to hear the gospel, we have that group, we have those circle of friends that are there supporting us, praying for us, praying with us, that we can share the gospel with our friends, and we have the courage to do so. And we're praying for the Holy Spirit to work through them. Ephesians, Colossians, Philippians, Paul opens up with these beautiful prayers about the church members growing not only closer to God, but growing in the depth of the knowledge of God, and encouraging them to keep going, encouraging them to develop relationships with one another. And then we see this passage in 2 Corinthians. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. He comforts us in all our affliction so that we are able to comfort those who are in any kind of affliction through the comfort we ourselves receive from God. So our relationship with God, our discipleship, our intellectual study doesn't just stop there. It also grows relationally, because we have to live out what we learn, because the comfort we receive from God when we're trying to figure out how to handle a situation in the family, at work, with whatever's going on in society or with a friend's life, whatever comfort God gives us there, we can pass it on to others, and God works through us. For just as the sufferings of Christ overflow to us, so also through Christ our comfort overflows. If we are afflicted, it's for your comfort and salvation. If we're comforted, it's for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings that we suffer. You know, if I'm going through something and I know a friend of mine's gone through the same thing, even though there's going to be differences in personalities and stuff, if it's similar enough, I know I can make it through if they did. And I can go to them and say, what did God do? How did you handle this? And there's comfort given because out of a similar situation, you can help somebody walk through it. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that as you share in the sufferings, you will also share in the comfort. And that comfort, and Paul is using the word God's mystery on purpose, because they're fighting again this Gnostic heretical teaching. And he references back to chapter 1, verse 27. God wanted to make known among the Gentiles the glorious wealth of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. When we love God, his word, and his people, the mystery of Christ unfolds, and we have access to all this wisdom and knowledge that God has. What does James write? God gives wisdom freely. All you have to do is ask. It's a promise in Scripture that when we need wisdom, when we need to figure out, God, what do you want us to do in this situation? How do you want me to handle this? I need you. God promises to give it if we don't doubt what he sends us. And sometimes he will send his wisdom through others that have been through a similar situation. So he's telling the church at Colossae, look, I just gave you a very headsy opening section about Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. Nothing is here that is not supposed to be here, and nothing is not here that doesn't need to be here, because Christ wants everything here that's already here. You know, you see all of this Christology, this affirming of Christ's deity, this affirming of the Godhead, the Trinity, who Christ is. And now Paul says, look, and people are calling this a mystery, but the mystery is Christ in you, the hope of glory. And you are to, as you love God, you are to love others with that same intensity. And the writings have begun to circulate by this point. And so you see this tying theme of agape, of God's love, of that perfect love that we all want to strive for, going throughout the New Testament. That if we're, God wants us to give him his best, and then he wants us to love others with our best. So we start to kind of wrap up, and some of you are going, man, you're kind of short-winded tonight, Mark. You know, that's okay. But reflective questions, just to think about. What do we agonize over? This is probably the biggest one that I'm going to be dealing and praying over the next little while. What do we agonize over daily? And in that agony, is it about someone we need to share the gospel with? Is it a way to encourage the church? Is that on our radar? Or is our agony over bills, job, family, relationships, schedule, calendar? I'm not saying those things, we shouldn't agonize over those things. Maybe, I don't know. I'm struggling with that. But in that agonizing, are we agonizing over the people we come in contact with that don't know the gospel? Are we agonizing over how they're going to hear? Are we agonizing over how can we encourage the church? How can we be a part of the body that God has called us to? Are we striving to truly love one another? To the best of our ability, with where we're at, with what God has called us to do, with where God has us in our journey with Him, are we loving others to the best of agape love that we can? And how is He challenging us to move deeper and to move forward? And just like when you teach, you tend to teach in the style that you like to learn in. And so those that like to learn in discussion are really good facilitators. Those that like to just sit and take notes make great lecturers. Those that enjoy learning by doing, they've got tables set up and have everybody sitting doing stuff. You teach typically the way that you best learn. And so as we get to know God, are we favoring study or are we favoring action? So how do we find balance? God wants us to know Him, wants to know His Word, but He also wants us to go into the world and share it. It's two sides of the same coin. How do we balance? I don't have the answer, because these are what I'm reflecting on, is what I'm sharing out of tonight, is what I'm dealing with out of studying this. But I also don't want to leave without giving a few action steps. Top, first and foremost, love God, love others. The first and second greatest commandment. The second, show forgiveness. Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 15. Therefore, as God's chosen ones, holy and dearly loved, put on compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a grievance against another, just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you are also to forgive. Above all, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity, and let the peace of Christ, to which you were also called in one body, rule your hearts, and be thankful. Embrace unity. Philippians 2, 1 through 4, where Paul says, you know, make my joy complete by having the same mind. Let me read that before I paraphrase it terribly. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, if any consolation of love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, make my joy complete by thinking the same way, having the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility consider others as more important than yourselves. Everyone should look out not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others. Embrace unity. Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, encourage restoration. Brothers and sisters, if someone is overtaken in any wrongdoing, you who are spiritual, restore such a person with a gentle spirit, watching out for yourselves so that you won't also be tempted. And then James 3, promote peace. James
James 3, 13 through 18. Who among you is wise and understanding? By his good conduct he should show that his works are done in the gentleness that comes from wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your heart, don't boast and deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there is disorder and every evil practice. Promote peace. But with wisdom from above is first pure, then peace-loving, gentle, compliant, full of mercy and good fruits, unwavering, without pretense. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who cultivate peace.
Promote peace. Then in Ephesians 6, suit up. Put on the full armor of God. Each day, I know people that pray on the armor of God when they get up in the morning before they go out. I know people that pray for others to put on the spiritual armor. Write it out, put it on the mirror, whatever. But have that in mind that we're in a battle. We're in a battle for eternity.
Finally, be strengthened by the Lord and by His vast strength. Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this darkness, against evil spiritual forces in the heavens. For this reason, take up the full armor of God so that you may be able to resist in the evil day, and having prepared everything, to take your stand. Stand, therefore, with truth like a belt around your waist, righteousness like armor on your chest, and your feet sandaled with readiness for the gospel of peace. In every situation, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Pray at all times in the Spirit with every prayer and request, and stay alert with all perseverance and intercession for all the saints.
This is another theme with Paul's. Praying for all the saints, praying for one another, praying for all believers, praying for the church universal. The heart of the matter is the balance between loving God and loving others. We are to love God preeminently, and we are to love others out of our love for God. We can't favor one over the other, because we have to be wise to what's being taught. We have to be wise to bad theology. We have to be wise to false gospels. And that means studying and knowing God's Word. But we also need to be relational and being able to live it out and love others the way that we love God. It's a both and. And so that's our challenge. Loving God, loving others, knowing God's Word, living God's Word. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this night. Father, I know you have challenged me on this. Father, I pray how you're working in others' hearts that are watching or are sitting in this room. Father, that you're working in them where you know needs to happen. Father, I do thank you for your Word. I thank you for Christ. I thank you for the mystery that we have found in Him. How you've brought us together, you've woven us together with our different gifts and abilities, Father, to take the gospel to a world that needs to know of your healing, needs to know of eternity. Father, both eternity, both heaven and hell. Father, give us an urgency to love you the greatest so we can love others best. In your name we pray, Father. Amen. Thank you, guys.